Recovering Queen, the Queen fan podcast where we talk about and play the songs we love with Jay, Matt, and Ian.
Welcome to Recovering Queen, the podcast where we take a Queen song, do a cover version of a Queen song, and then talk about what we've learned about that Queen song, the methods and the madness of the greatest band of all time, Queen, as if we needed to tell you that. Joining me tonight are Matt and Jay.
Hello. Good evening.
So, gentlemen, which Queen delight are we talking about this evening?
She makes me.
Yeah, she makes me.
Or to give it its full title, she makes me, open brackets, Stormtrooper in stilettos, close brackets.
Can I say right from the off here, this song, I appreciate loads more doing the cover of it. I absolutely love it. I think it's brilliant.
You can say it.
I've always liked it. I've never realised what an oddity it is within the Queen catalogue. I think it is utterly unique.
It is amongst Queen songs, for definite.
Yeah, absolutely. Within the Queen catalogue, there's nothing to compare it with.
If we ignore all the things like off stuff like Flash, for example, and sort of B-sides and stuff like that, in the Queen catalogue of album tracks from major albums, is there a song that's anywhere near this in terms of its inaccessibility?
No, I don't think so. And even, you know, Queen, one of the most diverse groups, and we've talked about that on previous podcasts, just how they can do an album of complete diverse stuff and it all sounds like one. There's nothing like this track. It's just a complete outlier.
It absolutely is the track that relates to the album cover itself more than anything else.
The
final section of it, that kind of sweaty, claustrophobic sound, is the album cover.
Didn't Brian describe that closing section as New York City nightmare or something? That's what he was going for.
You know the siren in it? He recorded that from his hospital bed.
Oh my God. In America?
No, in King's College, I think it was, in London.
Oh, right.
What I didn't realise, obviously the American tour had been cut short, so they were promoting Seven Seas of Rye with Mott the Hoople. That got cut short because of his hepatitis.
Yeah.
So that was doing really, really well. And then suddenly it's like, no, we've got to cancel it. Brian's really ill. So he's obviously rushed back to England, and the other three sort of camp out at Rockfield Studios in Wales and start working on Sheer Heart Attack with nothing else to do. And Brian's like shitting himself thinking he's going to get the sack. You know, he's got 6 weeks to recuperate.
And almost loses his arm.
Yeah, apparently very, very ill, well, as you are with hepatitis, and then turns up to Rockfield to kind of help out, but then instantly gets a duodenal ulcer. So it's his duodenal ulcer that ends up putting him in hospital again in London.
Oh my God, I had no idea about that.
So I think it's that hospital experience is when he records the sirens from his hospital bed.
And is that the nurses that are recording that heavy breathing at the end, just as they're administering whatever medicine that clears up a duodenal ulcer?
Yeah, God knows.
Well, it's certainly got that feel about it, hasn't it? I mean, you're right. The cover relating to this track absolutely perfectly. So you do get that kind of out of breath, horrible closeness to that. And the heavy breathing and the sirens. And I think there's an underground train sound that's going through it. It's a
city sound, isn't it?
Yeah, and probably stepping forward a little bit before we talk too much about the how the song is constructed. Towards the end, all those insane chords that are playing the same, rhythmically playing the same riff, but it goes all over the place, doesn't it?
It's quite a hypnotic track, is how I always think of it. I always end up feeling I'm getting sucked into it more and more. And then, I don't know, I'm hypnotized, I guess.
I mean, musically, it kind of goes from that Paul McCartney, Pink Floyd-y psychedelia type thing. So it's got that very sort of flower power chorus. Who knows where, as I lay, it's really sort of flower powery.
Yeah.
But then it goes into that really kind of almost velvet underground and sort of experimental Pink Floyd stuff. It's quite Pink Floyd-y. And I can't think of another Queen song which you could say was Pink Floyd-y at all.
No, absolutely. No.
And of course, he gets away with doing that. It's quite a relief in some respects, isn't it? That sort of repetition of the same sort of rhythmic and chord structure. So when it does break into that more melodic Beatles-esque, was it the chorus or is it middle eight? I never know.
Well, it's a chorus.
It's a weird chorus, though, isn't it?
I mean, it's a weird song structure. But those final chords that over that kind of droning bass, because the harmony guitar just gets left hanging, so it just goes, and it's almost like this drone of harmony guitars and the bass just droning through. But yeah, those chords, those acoustic guitar chords, they're sort of done in pairs, and I'd never noticed that before until obviously going to play it. So it's just jing, 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 jing. And they're different chords each time. Like everything's it's continually progressing and becoming more and more jarring as it goes through.
That's the bit I'd never noticed before. Because, I mean, it's relatively straightforward to play. I mean, the first verse, what's a D to A or A to D, isn't it? I mean, it's very, very simple. And there's, that so-called chorus, very simple. And then
is it easier to do the D to A or the A to the D?
Oh, well, A's a bit tricky, isn't it? Because you've got three fingers in a row on that one.
Whereas the D, it's slightly more comfortable.
You've got more space, so yeah.
sorry to interrupt your flow there.
Brian's not the only one playing acoustic guitar on this track.
No, John Deacon.
Oh, is it John?
Yeah, John Deacon plays acoustic.
Okay.
Yeah, because... And I think that's a hangover from the fact that while they're recording at Rockfield, John Deacon is the guitarist in the band. Mm. You know, because out of necessity, he's doing a lot of the guitar parts while they wait for May to get
better. Hence the whole misfire.
So they probably thought, or he thought, oh, I'll just put a few down. And then it was like, oh, yes, he's actually very good at guitar. So, and then Brian is sweating even more. Especially when he gets out the Red Special.
I mean, John's great at rhythm guitar. You know, but if you ever want an example of that, the stuff that he does on Hot Space, he's a much funkier guitarist than Brian is in terms of, I don't think Brian really can do the sort of thing that John does on Hot Space, but...
I wonder what his influences were.
He's a nifty musician.
The only influence I can ever remember was the Elvis Costello that he once quoted. But whose would his influences have been to get him so funked up?
Well, I know him and Freddie were massively into all the Motown stuff and Aretha Franklin and all those kind of things.
Yeah, she's my favourite bassist by far.
but it would have been, what's her name, Kay, the female bassist, wouldn't it, that did all that Motown stuff that would have been hugely influential. The only bass player I've ever heard John Deacon say as an influence is Chris Squire.
Oh, what about Rory Gallagher?
And the bass player from Rory Gallagher, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, really? Oh, that's interesting.
Well remembered.
that's way back in time.
I mean, God, you've remembered that for 20 years.
I have, waiting for the exact moment to bring it out. Finally.
Since the miracle. But okay, how do you feel about the song? Do you feel as though it's claustrophobic, melancholic? Do you think it's a love song?
It takes you on a deeply uncomfortable journey, I think. It's got the, starts off nicely enough, but then obviously turns into the New York nightmare, as we've discussed. Overall, the production's very disorientating. I mean, the drums are unrecognizable as being Roger, really. The whole production doesn't sound that much like Queen. Some of the lyrics are a little bit odd in that Brian May vein as well.
For me, I would have thought the most obvious interpretation of this, particularly considering the Stormtroopers in Stilettos, and we should point out that bit is pre-Star Wars, so Stormtroopers refers to German World War I troops rather than Stormtroopers.
Is that referring to the kind of walking pace of the song, the kind of plodding... along. Is that what it's referring to?
I know.
That's
no,
nice.
It's not. No, it isn't.
Right.
Well, at least I don't think it is, because I seem to remember that it was Roger wanted an extra bit of the title. No, he was saying, I love the song. great song, but I really don't like the title, which was just She Makes Me. We need to have something. So it was almost like a throwaway comment. I might be wrong. I might just make that up, but I'm sure it was along those lines.
Right.
But why that particular words, I don't know.
Okay.
Brian May, in the other song that he writes for this, Now I'm Here, for Sheer Heart Attack, writes about a woman called Peaches, mm-hmm. who notoriously met in the Dungeon Club in New York, hence the New York nightmare sound.
Uh-huh.
And the Dungeon Club is exactly where you would expect to find the kind of kinky dressing of a woman, a dominatrix, wearing German army uniform while wearing stilettos.
Crikey. Yeah.
I would have thought that that's the most obvious interpretation of
that.
That's... Absolutely ties in lyrically, absolutely. She makes me, as I lie in her cocoon, I'm scared, but I'm warm.
It is.
You know, the whole thing is a deeply kind of sexual.
He's jealous of her.
Masochistic. Yeah, he's jealous of her.
And there's something about leaving her as well.
It definitely feels as though it's a controlling relationship. So he knows this woman's really bad for him. But he loves her, but he knows he has to leave her because she's so bad for him. But he's going to love her still once he's left her. I mean, that is the lyric. I mean, it's like it's not even slightly hidden.
Yeah, but I mean, is that true? If that's true, then I won't waste any more time.
What's true?
Well, as in, is that what Brian said is the explanation?
No, not at all. But I mean, what else does Stormtrooper and Stilettos mean if it's not?
I think it's the pace of the song, the kind of really plodding, really heavy, but somehow kind of a little bit light as well.
Hmm. Could it be something maybe just like something a bit of fun throw in there? For people like us to talk about for the next 40 or 50 years.
Yeah. And it could have been a throwaway comment by Freddie, couldn't it? You know, oh, you two guys are just like Stormtroopers in stilettos, you know, easily. Who knows? Do you know, listeners, if you know the origin of brackets Stormtroopers in stilettos, close brackets, do write in to the Twitter at Recovering Q to let us know.
Whatever it is, it's claustrophobic, isn't it? What's interesting, though, have you noticed how much Sheer Heart Attack is a complete change of gear to Queen 2? Queen 2 is like very prog rock, very fantasy driven. And then suddenly we've got Sheer Heart Attack, which is all about being in the city and being vulnerable and all those kind of sort of things going on. Nothing like Queen 2. I mean, I cannot believe how different those two albums are, considering how close they are in terms of when they're recorded.
Overlapping writing as well.
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly my favourite album. It's got to be up there, isn't it?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It's up there.
Yeah, I mean, it's the first album where they've gone, right, let's be slightly grittier, but slightly more commercial at the same time. So they're sort of turning into a bit more of a recognisable rock band, aren't they? Including the sort of album cover as well.
And again, I think it's probably when they realise that a couple of good smash hit singles is the way to go. They've realised. So Freddie just turns it on with Killer Queen and the final version of Seven Seas of Rye.
Yeah, I mean, Killer Queen's cracking, isn't it?
Yeah. It's funny though, because... You know, you were both talking about it being such a unique song. I mean, I think I've just misinterpreted it all these years, because I've just thought that's just a really lovely song. And I think, oh yeah, there's a bit of heavy breathing at the end, but yeah, nothing to see there. That's just a bit of heavy breathing. But yeah, now I think of it, it is quite claustrophobic, but I've never ever interpreted it like that when I used to listen to it.
But they've done claustrophobic songs before. I always find... Get Down, Make Love has kind of got a little bit of that element to it.
Yeah.
Very strange, very, very weird. But that to me just fits in that kind of Freddie way of writing. Very unusual, very odd. You know, it's kind of, you know, bicycle race type stuff. It's very odd. But it's the whole package with She Makes Me. You know, the really floaty acoustic guitars, the plodding drums, the weird construction, is it a verse, is it a melody, is it a chorus? And then the whole, you know, the ending section, I think unique.
Yeah.
And it's very drawn out. It's unlike Queen to sort of remain on one or a couple of ideas just rolling and rolling. I mean, absolutely. Let's face it, Queen like to stick in about 5 billion ideas into the first minute of anything.
Yeah.
And yet this doesn't even attempt it. It's just like, no, I'm just going to keep going.
Absolutely.
But it just feels so right, doesn't it? Because when it opens up into...
Lap of the Gods Revisited.
It's such... I don't know, to me, it almost felt... conceptual in the second half, and that bit is the release from that song in a way for me. It is like, oh, okay. And then it launches in this massive melody, which is really counter, isn't it, to what's been going on with She Makes Me.
No, but lyrically, they're both about helplessness, surely. They have a sort of lyrical theme of in the lap of the gods, obviously, and this one is this person pinned down by a woman and he's helpless.
This is in the dungeon you're talking about.
Yeah. Well, it could be in the sex dungeon,
help me, they might be looking in through the window down at the basement.
It's a bit of a convoluted way to ask for help, isn't it? Record an album, have it released, and then say, I think Brian's trying to tell us something here.
I'm sticking with my peaches in the dungeon.
It's good. I like theory. It. We all get out of it what we see, I guess.
No, but it has to. The lyrics have to be about helplessness. I mean, there is no other interpretation. Some people have said it's about suicide,
and the she is the suicide, or that
she is the person causing him to commit suicide. Okay. I think that's a little bit over the top myself.
Yeah, he's always got a strange melancholy, or often, hasn't he, old Bry? With a lot of his songs, we're discovering more and more this really kind of sad, lonely edge, lost kind of edge to a lot of his writing.
Yeah. And a little bit pathetic as well, as in, you know, like being controlled by event. Not being horrible to Brian, that's what he's writing about, it's not him. But, but yeah, I don't know. Some have said it's about an overbearing mother as well, that the she is a mother figure.
Yeah, yeah.
Hence the line, I know the day I leave her, I'll love her still.
Ah, yeah.
Do you know what I really love about it is that at the end of the day, you know, Freddie is the majesty when it comes to vocals, obviously. But I don't think it would have worked with Freddie doing this kind of track. He's got too much presence, melody. Life. I don't know what it is, but it works with Brian singing it. And that for me is such a joy. I think maybe we've all said this in the past that we missed the other guys singing on the earlier albums, in the later albums. And here you get the shades and what they can all do. And then it's all so much the better when it comes into Lap of the Gods for me. I love Brian singing on this actually. It's really lovely.
Yeah, because it's fragile and it's vulnerable. Freddie struggles with that because he's not, is it? It's powerful and commanding. that's what Freddie does well.
Yeah, absolutely. Almost Brian's vocal is almost part of the instrumentation, isn't it? The weaker voice, lower in the mix. It's not an energetic performance. I'm not sure you could do an energetic performance of the vocals. What do you think, Matt? Is it really all legato and quite low key when you're singing it, or do you have to belt it out?
No, you do have to belt it out. It's without a doubt his top note, that I love is definitely his top note, I reckon, that he can sing. And that's why he kind of keeps going to it. It's like a sort of chime that goes throughout the whole song. So he's definitely going for it in full
voice.
It makes it
such a strange verse, doesn't it? You know, it's just two notes on that bit, isn't it? Yeah. So it's very, very strange. But so there's some incredibly high backing vocals, isn't there? She is my love bits, those bits later on, and they get some very, very complex harmonies there as well. So I'm guessing Roger must have been drafted in for the super high bits, because some of them are very, very high towards the end.
doesn't sound like there's Roger in that
doesn't.
Mix
no,
at all.
That's what, because you,
I think that Brian did a lot of this on his own.
It doesn't sound like the Queen, the Queen backing vocal thing that they do. It sounds like a solo track. So maybe he is doing the falsetto, or they did some studio trickery to, you know, he sang it at half speed or something, or double speed. However they did it.
Yeah, I mean, the bit I struggled with was the fact that just like 39, he played his Ovation 12 string. And obviously that gives the song quite a lot of sort of massive, that sort of massive acoustic sound. Yeah,
absolutely.
But I sort of got around that by playing an electric guitar and sort of mixing it in a little
That's what this project's taught us, isn't it? That A, we should have started this project
got a
12 string guitar each, and you also need a 24 fretted electric guitar to be able to play a lot of Brian stuff, because have 24 frets, you got to use them. And annoyingly, they do. I've come across a couple of times now where it's like, oh, hang on a minute. Need to go and buy a new guitar to do this song.
Well, the good thing is I'm normally tuned down either four semitones, so I'm nowhere near hitting the 24th fret.
Yeah, yeah. So did you have to transpose that one, Matt, or was that strange?
No, so I made the mistake of recording it in D. Only to find actually that Brian's got a slightly higher voice than mine.
It's probably one that wouldn't work with different chords, though, is it? Those opening chords are so distinctive.
Yeah, because I've come unstuck with a couple of those where it's like, the nice opening chords, and it's like, you either have to detune the guitar or come up with something completely
different.
I've
come unstuck so many times when you know, especially trying to do a Freddie song, and you're five semitones at least down, and then all of a sudden the bass line that was nice and bassy, there's nowhere for it to go, so all of a sudden it's like almost, you know, it's too high really, for it doesn't have the same effect.
Well, luckily I've got a five-string bass for that.
Incredible. Well, I think if more guitar shops had been open during lockdown, I'd have definitely been buying a 24 fretted guitar. To go, I've been saved by the situation here.
You know, Matt, earlier on when you were talking about the tour being cancelled with Mott the Hoople, when Brian went to hospital, I came across a lovely quote that I'd never seen before. And it was from Freddie saying something like, supporting Mott the Hoople was the most traumatic, I mean, as in being the support, was the most traumatic experience of his life. And it was brilliant.
Well, yeah, funny.
Didn't Mott the Hoople find it quite traumatic as well to have Queen at that time as the support band? I think it wasn't great after the first few nights when, you know, the support act, the place was packed, and then allegedly it would possibly thin out a little bit for Mott the Hoople, certainly later on in the tour.
I mean, what would they do? Would they turn down their amps? You'll try and...
Oh God, I'm not sure. But you know, Mott, they'd had that big hit, hadn't they? All the young dudes. So they were, you know, obviously the bigger band, but from what I've read about those tours, it was quite uncomfortable, particularly in America.
Queen were only really promoting Seven Seas of Rye at that point, weren't they? So it's not like Queen had any sort of big hits.
No, I think word was going around that they were quite good live. So,
well, that's that sort of thing, isn't it? That you start the tour in one place, and you know, with the music industry, things can go pretty fast. Really, you know, think you can blow up, can't you? Essentially, into a big band almost overnight. And I know, obviously, you have to put the work in the first place, but it can happen really quickly. And that must be awful at the start of the tour, as for Mott the Hoople. And you've got like Queen coming, oh, yeah, come on, lads, come on. And then it's like, oh my God, they're amazing. It's like they're absolutely. And then all of a sudden they're doing loads better than you. It's like, God, when's this tour going to end? I mean, could you just imagine the stress?
And we've talked about it before, haven't we? That, you know, the four very strong personalities in the band, so you can only imagine what it must have been like being on tour with them, and them, you know, supposed to be the support band, but I imagine they made their presence felt very strongly that it was perhaps the wrong way around. You know, just speculating, but you know, from what we've learned about you know, the personalities, I think that there's possibly an element of that.
Freddie definitely did that thing where it's like, you've got to believe you're a star, or you won't become one.
Yeah.
Well, what would Mott the Hoople be coming on after? What would be the last couple of songs? Do we know what the last couple of songs in the set would have been around that point?
Keep Yourself Alive might have been
that might
in there,
be an opener. They'd probably finish with Lap of the Gods Revisited, wouldn't they? With that huge, great chorus.
What, with the whole crowd? The whole crowd singing, la, 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 la. Right, we're on.
And all the young do.
Good song. All the young did.
It is a good song. It is a good song.
To be fair, Mott the Hoople were really good and they were like a proper strong band, but Queen must have been extraordinary at that point.
Yeah. And you know, and this isn't recovering Hoople, is it?
No.
Oh, there's an idea.
There are quite a few bands to get through before we get to recovering Hoople.
It just flows, doesn't it?
I like the name.
It's good. So don't forget, listeners, you can get in touch with us on the Twitter at Recovering Queen or on the World Wide Web at recoveringqueen.co.uk. Please do get in touch. But here it is, the Brian May illness classic, She Makes Me, Stormtrooper in Stilettos.